You're looking at Grande Communication Stadium in Midland, Texas. That's right. They packed up the vans and moved the show down south to Midland. It is the spring game. The Texas Tech offense taking on the Texas Tech defense. Good afternoon, or morning, I guess, everyone. Robert Giovanetti alongside of Chris Lovell. And, Chris, a great environment here already in Midland. A lot of alums here, a lot of fans, been a lot of tailgating since early on. We got a little football this afternoon.
You smell a little, the big grill smell in the air. It smells like, tailgating. Smells like football season. First of all, football being played. It's a nice day. You and I are working together. It ought to be a good one. And, hey, I know a lot of people wish they were in Lubbock right now and that they were seeing the spring game there. We're in Midland. Couldn't be more excited to be here. And, anxious to see kind of what this football program looks like about 8 practices through.
Funny you should say that. Why are we here in Midland? Well, one of the reasons, because back home at Jones AT&T Stadium, a little construction going on. As you take a look there at some of the video of the stadium, the seats being torn out and being renovated.
There's nowhere to sit.
Yeah. You could, I guess, stand, or you could sit on the concrete flooring there, but nowhere for the fans to come out. So, again, that's why we're down here in Midland. Of course, they were here last year in Midland for a scrimmage. I thought, come back down here and have the spring game. And this is a little different also because typically the spring game means the end of spring practice, but we're just about halfway through for these guys.
Yeah, and you have to be careful about what you see today because you'll want to take some assumptions away from this is how it's been all spring, but they're only halfway through. I think this is practice number 8. They've got, I think, 7 more after today. And so, the coaches are still trying to identify who can do what, who fits where. There'll be some guys that are held out today, like Davis Webb. I don't think he's going to practice today, but again, this is a work in progress, and everybody moving forward with this spring practice.
We will see Patrick Mahomes, even though baseball is playing back home against Kansas. Mahomes is here, and he'll play today. Now, we are going to have a real limited scrimmage time where the ones will go against the ones, twos go against the two, and the timing will be a little different. You'll see it'll be a 15-minute first quarter with the live kickoff. Then another 15-minute quarter, we'll have a 15-minute special team segment, a 5-minute break, and then a 30-minute half with just a running clock. And so that's why we'll have a lot of special guests with us today. We'll hear from Cliff Kingsbury in a little while ourselves. We'll have Kirby Hocutt, Texas Tech Athletics Director, here on the set with us. And we'll hear from a lot of the fine folks in Midland. But we'll do all that throughout the course of these 2 hours.
As it's typical with one of these spring practices or red and black game thing, there are no rules.
we want.
So just bear with us.
You can throw a frisbee here if we wanted to.
That's right. If Cliff Kingsbury sees something that he wants to see a little bit more of, or he's seen enough of, he may just stop what he's doing, send some guys to the sideline, say, okay, we're good there, or guys, stay out there. So it's loosely scripted. How about that?
But I love that.
You will see Patrick Mahomes. I think he is clearly the starting quarterback right now because Davis Webb has not really been cleared because of that shoulder surgery that he had. And I know many people anxious to see what does it look like now compared to how we finished the season up, because last time we saw him,
he looked pretty good.
Pretty good.
He looked pretty good. There's no doubt against the Baylor Bears. So we got all that ahead. We've got to have guests. So stick with us. 2 hours of Texas Tech athletics, Texas Tech football. You're watching Texas Tech TV on Fox. Robert Giovanetti alongside my man Chris Lovell. It's the spring game here at Texas Tech football. We're going to have Kirby Hocutt on later. Going to have Cliff Kingsbury on later. Of course, going to have some of the action on the field. Speaking of the action on the field, we have a third member of our crew, Courtney Davis. She is down on the field with a very special guest.
Thanks, Robert. Rumor mill is Dale Redmond, one of my favorite people in Red Raiders. You're responsible for the best party in West Texas this weekend.
Well, first of all, I'm not responsible. I'm just a very small part.
Hey,
our employees and team have done a great job. But I didn't put all this together. Not at all.
Well, how special is it for Pro Petro to be involved with Texas Tech football and this entire Midland production here for the spring game?
Courtney, I mean, I've got so many good memories of Texas Tech and what it's meant to my family's life, and to have everybody descend on the Permian Basin is really fantastic, and so excited for what Cliff and his staff are doing, and Kirby and the whole athletic department, and to have them here for everybody to see is really special.
You've had a chance to get out there and have some barbecue and enjoy the tailgating. Set the scene for me out there. You said over 10,000 Red Raiders are enjoying themselves before they come out and watch practice.
Well, I hope they're able to get in here. I don't know that all 10,000 will be able to get here for whatever reason, but it's a really great crowd, Courtney.
Lastly, before I let you get out of here, what does it mean for Texas Tech to come down here to Midland each and every year and host this event for several Red Raider fans who may not be able to make that trek up to Lubbock during the season?
Yeah, I think it speaks volumes of the support here in the Permian that Texas Tech has. And I think any time that you can bring your brand to other areas outside of Lubbock is tremendous. And we've got a great alum here. Yeah, group, and we've got a lot of kids that want to go to Texas Tech, so it's really special.
Well, I appreciate you, ProPetro, and all the other vendors here in the Permian Basin welcoming us in. I'll let you enjoy the game from here on out. Robert, I'll send it back to you.
Thank you, Courtney, and thank you to Dale Redmond. We're now joined by Tim Culp. He is the president of Desert Production here in Midland, also part of the planning committee. Get tired of falling after Dale Redmond?
God, I tell you what, it's those big shoes to fill, no doubt about it, Gio. You're absolutely right. I'm always just riding his coattails,
hey,
no doubt.
We heard from Dale about how great this is for Midland. You must love this for your community and what's going on.
Absolutely. This is Red Raider country, has been for many, many years, and to have the opportunity to bring the football team down again for the third consecutive year has been great for us, great for our community, not just Midland, Odessa, but the entire Permian Basin. So we're excited to have them down here. Great weather. 7 days ago, we'd have been here with umbrellas because it was nasty weather. But today, we called it for some great weather, and we're so glad to have Red Raiders football team, cheerleaders, band. It's going to be a great day for football.
And Tim, do people realize this is the third year that you guys have done this and hosted this, but a lot of work goes on, and it's not just today. I mean, a lot of prep, a lot of people involved here.
Well, as you know, Chris, there's a lot of behind the scenes that goes on to plan this. This was an idea that Jay Isaacs came up with and talked to Kirby about. Jay's a banker here in Midland, lived in Lubbock for a few years, and Jay talked to Kirby several years ago about bringing a function, the football team, down, and that's where the idea began, and Bobby Burns got involved, and they asked me to. I've got a lot of Texas Tech alum that I have contacts with, and we just put together a committee and started raising the money to get Texas Tech down here. We don't have to pay Tech to come down here. That's not why they're here. They want to, as Kirby will tell you, this is a great base for Red Raider alum and fans and supporters, and they're going to come down, but we this is just a way for them to help pay back.
It's an extension of Lubbock.
Absolutely. We call it Lubbock South, Texas Tech South. Absolutely.
Tim, you and obviously others, very passionate fans. What's your favorite Texas Tech memory, football memory?
Oh, it's got to be the Crabtree catch against UT in 2009, no doubt about it. I grew up in Andrews, went to Tech. I've been born and raised West Texan, and have been to I don't know how many hundreds, maybe thousands of Texas Tech activities and events over the years, but the Graham Harrell to Crabtree catch in the last minute, the last few seconds of that
pretty
game.
Pretty good one, yes.
Absolutely, no doubt about it.
All right, thank you again. Appreciate all your work.
Thank you for having me, guys. Thanks for coming down.
Tim Culp of Desert Production. Let's go back to the field in Courtney.
Hey, Robert, one of the many storylines throughout the spring game today that most fans would like to watch for is, as most would tell you, number 7 is the lucky number, and Texas Tech football is hoping that's just the case with their 7th defensive coordinator in 7 years in David Gibbs. The players have really taken to his style of teaching, though. Two words that really come up when they describe him is he's so intense, yet so patient. Two words that don't normally go together in a sentence. However, with Texas Tech football and Texas Tech defense, that's just the case.
The intensity, the sense of urgency, trying to get everything done, you know, maximize every rep.
He's very patient. I think he has a plan and he knows how he wants to install it, and he seems to be a great teacher. The biggest thing I've noticed is physicality has picked up, and that's something he's coaching towards.
A lot more turnover worried, you know, those guys have definitely been trying to get at the ball. I think it's they're going to get a lot of the bounces to go their way this year.
I'm just trying to, you know, build a foundation of playing sound fundamental defense.
Eyes up.
You know, guys being in their proper gaps and knowing their responsibilities, and and executing them. That way you can make adjustments.
There's a sense of urgency over there. Guys are running to the ball. Guys are, you know, there's a lot of energy over there. And I'm looking forward to watching them play this year.
A lot to be excited about with Coach Gibbs and his new defensive scheme here at Texas Tech. We've got a lot more to go. Kickoff coming up in just a bit. You're watching Texas Tech TV on Fox.
We ever went there, I clearly remember just looking out the bus and there's like tailgating. I'm like, are we scrimmaging? Like, are we playing Texas or are we scrimmaging?
Yeah, I was talking to one of the guys and they were telling me about how it's like pretty much a Texas high school playoff game. And they was like, you get to experience Texas high school football, but it's like on a college level. So that's going to be exciting. I'm really excited to see what that's like.
You're looking at a pretty good crowd already here at Grande Communications Stadium as we're just past 11 o'clock. Robert Giovanetti and Chris Love with you. Courtney Davis down on the field with us all the way up until 1 o'clock. And it is a great, you know, we talked to Tim Culp, Dale Redmond, of course. These guys are great Red Raiders. So many, you and I have come down here and spoken to groups before. It's just a really great environment here in Midland.
Yeah, Tech Baseball going to play at Rockhouse Stadium as well. And I think these players, when you're talking about this football team, you hear some of them there, Tevin Madison and Mike Alway and guys like that, but it breaks up the monotony. You know, going out to the practice field or Jones Stadium, everything like that for 15 practices in the spring is fun, but I think when you get to, you know, it's almost like high school again. When you get on a bus, go down, and just like a road trip, camaraderie takes you back, and it's a little bit of a bonding experience with these guys, and I think they enjoy it. I think, you know, you get to see some different people in a different venue and all that stuff, so I think they're looking forward to it. And typically, the last couple of years, these kids are really put on a show. They've played to the environment, and it's better than just sitting there in a closed practice on Saturday afternoon and love it.
Hannah, when I was driving down, I drove down a little bit later than you this morning, already a caravan of Tech fans coming down here, so I know we've got some Lubbock people here as well. So I know the Midland folks have come out, but the Lubbock folks have decided they're going to come down and see the Red Raiders as well. Well, you know what? The reason we're here is watch the spring game. So we'll come back. Let's do that. Kickoff coming up after this. You're watching Texas Tech TV on Fox. For Texas Tech football, about halfway through spring practice this season for Cliff Kingsbury and his staff. A lot to work on throughout the remainder of the spring. Robert Giovanetti and Chris Lovell here with you. And we've already got our first kind of change in plans because we're going to talk a lot about Taylor Semenk, and he's not going to kick today.
Yeah, and for people who don't realize who Taylor is, obviously he was your punter last year. He was in line to be your kickoff guy right now. And people may not realize this. He was really being, I think, you're practicing as your first team specialist as far as kickoffs, extra points, field goals, all that good stuff. But going to sit it out today. I guess a little injury issue there. And so Clayton Hatfield will likely get a lot of the looks, you know, replacing Kramer Fife and all right. That. So we were waiting for kickoff, but the guy that we thought was going to kick it off going to be held out today. And you have several players that will be held out today. Again, I think that, again, this is just a practice. You want to make sure you're taking care of, you know, it's not. Maybe some of these guys could have gone in games, but that's not what this is today.
And one of the guys we talked about earlier in the broadcast that a lot of people might want to see, Davis Webb, will not play today either. So that's going to give Patrick Mahomes a lot of the reps this afternoon. And then, of course, we'll see some of the other guys, too, that maybe people don't know as much about at the quarterback position. A lot of people interested to see Coach Gibbs. We've heard from Coach Gibbs already in his defense, what changes we can see from the defense. I know it's going to be a bit of a mystery to us, too, because practices have been closed for the most part.
Yeah, you know, and I think when you're talking about David Gibbs, the reason why he's here is because the man has been doing this for about 20, 25 years, and his defense has created turnovers. And if you've watched Tech football in the last 3 to 5 years, they've had an issue with that. I think that his defenses in Houston have caused, I think, twice as many turnovers in the last 2 years as your defenses have. And that's obviously something that he's here to fix. But unfortunately, you've had a run where you've had to replace defensive coordinators for several years in a row. But David Gibbs, hopefully, is here for a long time.
All right, I believe we are ready to go. As you look on the field, they are getting themselves ready to go on the field. So we're ready to play. We've also got Michael Barton, who's also maybe a guy that we see in the kicking mix. So a couple of freshmen taking an event. This is what the other great thing about spring. You have an opportunity to prove yourself early on, right?
Yeah, and that's what these are. This is one of 15, you know, practices here in the spring, and you're trying to make yourself get yourself on the radar and trying to make these position coaches aware. So Darren Cheverini will be paying attention to these guys without some ink out there.
And Hatfield is the guy that's going to kick off for the Red Raiders, freshman out of Bernie. So We are just about ready to go on a beautiful afternoon here in Midland. A little bit of wind, but not a whole lot. Temperature 74 degrees. Just a beautiful afternoon for football. And I'd imagine we've got 10,000 or more of Red Raider faithful here today. Came out to Grande Communication Stadium to watch the game. And we're just about ready to go. Got an officiating crew as well. We were here when they rolled in. Chris, I believe we're ready to play a little football. Hatfield kicks it off. Of course, we're in a kind of a weird angle down here on the other side of the end zone. That's returned out just past the 20-yard line.
And right now, what you'll see is going to start about a 30-minute period here where you get a lot of the first team offense against the majority of the guys that are, I think, expected to play a lot of defense for you in the fall. And I think that there's some depth concerns on the offensive line. So right now you'll see this first team offensive line, which does feature a guy that, you know, I think some folks were a little nervous that he may go ahead and take it to the next level. But LaRaven Clark is back, and good to see him back here this spring and anchoring that offensive line at left tackle.
We'll hear more about LaRaven later on in the broadcast. Courtney was able to sit down with him. Patrick Mahomes completes his first pass of the afternoon.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Kevin Lauderdale on the reception.
Yeah, the narrative with Pat has certainly changed because of the success he had at the tail end of last year, and just I think he's kept that up this spring. And the big thing is he's taking care of the football. So you'll hear Coach Kingsbury say it all the time. You know, really, it's not about how many plays you can make. It's who can run the offense and take care of the ball the most is going to earn the job. And so far through spring, Pat has done that. So hopefully, I know that's what his head coach wanted him to do again today.
DeAndre Washington on the carry there had over 1,100 yards last season on the ground. It obviously gives you a nice dimension. Mahomes, last time we saw him, completed 30 passes. And this is one of the things that's great about Patrick. He can throw on the run as that pass is incomplete. Looks like attempted for Jakeem Grant.
Yeah, I think Jakeem dropped it. But what you see is you see Pat able to make a play, extend a play. You know, he's got that athleticism that you're looking for. But three and out right there by the defense to start things off. So I know David Gibbs will be pleased. But, again, it's fun when the play breaks down and watching Pat do his thing, because these receivers love it because they're never out of a play.
So what do you expect we're going to see now after the change here? Will Patrick play at quarterback throughout these first –
I think you'll see him for you know, several series here. Bottom line is the head coach wants to see him have some success. He probably won't come out of this thing until they have some success and score a couple times, certainly once. That's just the way this thing will go. And if that's 12-15, if that's 11-40, I'm not sure. But that's likely how this thing will go.
As we mentioned earlier, this could go any way that Cliff Kingsbury wants it to go.
Yeah, and now you see maybe the twos coming in right now. But Pat's going to get some looks here. As you've got, I believe, Nick Szymanek in at quarterback right there, the Iowa transfer.
So this is our first.
Wearing Cliff Kingsbury's old number. How about that?
Yeah,
for
a little
heavy
pressure
praise.
When your head coach used to wear number 16 and then you play the same position wearing the 16. Szymanek, a guy that not a lot of people know about. That was almost picked off.
Yeah, and you'll hear Cliff and Eric Morris, offensive coordinator, kind of describe Nick Szymanek. He really has an arm on him. His athleticism is somewhere in between, you know, Davis Webb and, you know, Patrick Mahomes and all that stuff. But he really just needs reps, needs to play, and he's going to get an opportunity quite a bit today.
That was Dakota Allen on the breakup. We'll pass.
A wide receiver screen right there.
Yeah, the screen.
Yep.
So it'll be third down. It looks like Brad Pearson on the reception. And, you know, almost going to be two consecutive three and outs possibly.
And good to have Brad Pearson back. That's a junior right there last year that thought he had wrapped up his Red Raider career, was going to get off into the you know, business world and all that, and decides to come back for senior year. So glad to have Brad back. Great Lubbock product right there.
Szymanek on the move, and of course that's you can do that with ease when you're wearing the red jersey.
That's what David Gibbs will tell you about these quarterbacks. He goes, they ought to be having a good spring. He goes, they know we can't touch them. Yeah. They know we can't get to them. So you're darn right, they better move around in the pocket and run with the ball whenever they get a chance.
He got out in the open field, and they blew it dead. So again, another nice possession there by the defense.
Always plenty of gamesmanship and practices between the whoever the OC and the DC is and things like this. And, you know, I'll be curious if Coach Gibbs allowed to blitz today and all that, because the head coach is obviously the ultimate offensive coordinator here, the play caller, if you will. And so he can say, yeah, Coach Gibbs, you can blitz all you want, or guess what? You got to keep that to yourself for another day.
So Patrick Mahomes back out for his second series. Again, Davis Webb not playing this afternoon.
And I think if it was in the fall, he could have played. They're just trying to be really safe and be careful with him with that shoulder surgery right there that he had.
Another wide receiver screen and then breaks it loose. Our depth perception here is really...
Patrick Mahomes pass complete to number two, Reginald Davis.
Reginald Davis on the reception.
Yeah, Reg in a position battle right now at that Z receiver with Dylan Cantrell. And Reg really needs to have a good spring, but I think they're really looking for him to step up.
Quick screen out again to the sideline. And
Mahomes pass complete to Reginald Davis.
Again, Reginald Davis.
Yeah, Reg, you know, just 29 catches last year. I think people just really thought that he would have a much bigger year, just a little inconsistent. And he needs to do what Bradley Marquez did last year and just be more consistent on an everyday basis. I think if he does that, you know, you'll see a much bigger year from him.
Wind kicking up a little bit here in Midland. Keeping it on the ground. You think back to last year and just the difference this year from last year in the spring. Of course, last year, a little bit different weather situation. We were at Jones Stadium. At that time, we were looking a lot at Davis Webb as Justin Stockton carried the ball.
And, you know, and Webb in this practice here in Midland last year and then the Red and Black game and the Friday Night Lights event they had last spring, Davis just lit it up.
Yes.
He was, really, really good. And it just didn't translate for him. Some injuries dictated that, but it just didn't translate. As you see, a nice little move right here.
Still on the...
Yes.
Well, all the way down inside the 10-yard line.
That's DeMarcus Felton. Yeah, you're going to hear his name a lot, folks. This is a running back that redshirted last year. You talk to a lot of these offensive skill players, DeAndre included, and they're like, watch out for Mr. Felton. Mike Jinks, the running backs coach, has the best situation on this team. He's got a 1,000-yard rusher. He's got Quentin White back. He's got Justin Stockton back, who's one of the fastest guys. And then this new addition here in DeMarcus Felton that Tech fans, until about right now, you haven't really had a chance to see, but that looked pretty good there.
Yeah, plenty to like there as he broke that open along the sideline and almost busted it all the way. Again, there's no score being kept today. And last year we had the kind of the complicated scoring system. No such scoring system this year. Dylan Cantrell on the reception there.
Interesting that you're in the red zone right now. Two back set right there. And I'll be just to see if we get a handoff to DeAndre Washington. Just 1,100 yards rushing last year, but just two touchdowns. That's something that I know Coach Kingsbury really wanting to improve is that red zone efficiency, especially with DeAndre.
Mahomes looks like he's changing the play here at the line of scrimmage.
Hand it to number 21. Let's
give
see
it
what
to
happens.
21 and... Mahomes going to take it himself, it looks like. Now he's trying to find the receiver. That'll be a touchdown, it looks like. It's hard to see from here.
Yeah, Dylan Cantrell. Yeah.
Interesting to Dylan Cantrell for the first touchdown of the afternoon. Mahomes and Cantrell, a couple of guys from the same hometown.
Yeah, White House to White House. How about that? And, you know, our viewpoint here in the end zone is a unique one because I think actually that play was not called for Dylan Cantrell.
Looks like it's going to go to DeAndre.
Absolutely. That's Pat on an option play. It looks like where he can either dump it down to DeAndre or run it himself, but sees Dylan kind of coming across. And you mentioned that chemistry. Boy, they certainly have that back since their high school days.
And there's the extra point. Hatfield with the extra point. So we will take a break. We're watching the spring game for Texas Tech football here on Texas Tech TV on Fox.
I mean, it's funny because, you know, freshman year seemed like it was yesterday. And, like, I just came in, and now it's, like, through all these 3 years, everything changed. I think my job this year is to lead by example, by doing what I'm supposed to do and just making everyone else better on the team.
I got beat sometimes, and I made some plays. And now just going into the next season, you know, having some experience and trying to help the guys out and trying to get everybody lined up, is the experience is going to help me out a lot and be able to help me help others out a lot.
You just have to go out there every day, and you have to work as hard as you want to work every day. You can't have days off. You have to have the days back to back to back to back. And just doing that, I think that if we're doing that, we'll have a great 2015 season.
We're back to hear some of those guys talk about their different roles. Level, we have to correct ourselves. That was Quentin White on the big pass play.
I think it was all you, man. Q White, obviously, with a nice nice screen pass right there. And Q's playing a lot of fullback this spring. They've asked him to add some weight. And a lot of those two-back sets, he is that other running back. And he was that primary third-down back last year. And nice to see some wiggle right there from, I think they call him in the locker room, they call him Spin Move. Is his nickname? So,
bad snap over Szymanek's head.
Yeah,
brings up a second and long type of situation. Again, not keeping a score today. As we look at the sophomore quarterback wearing his head coach's former number, gets forced out of the pocket, goes back across the middle, and
guess what?
How about that,
DeMarcus Felton?
That is Felton.
Yeah, that's
27.
The one who caught that one. Yes,
we're a little easier to see. And again, not trying to make excuses, but we're in kind of a weird corner of the end zone. It's hard to see the action from where we are here, but that one was Felton. So Szymanek, you see the marker there on the near sideline, third, and let's call it about six for the sophomore quarterback. Patrick Mahomes looking pretty comfortable in his two series so far. Szymanek forced and sack.
You got some of those backup offensive linemen, and that's one of the storylines of this spring, certainly, is just the lack of depth on the offensive line. You've got regular starter Baylen Brown, who is out this spring, and Tony Morales coming back from an injury, so he's out. So you just technically have one scholarship player on your second-team offensive line. Right now, so Lee Hayes talking to him before the scrimmage. He's the one that coaches that offensive line. He's ready for that recruiting class that five-member recruiting class to get here, and they just added to that yesterday. Should expect six players here in June on that offensive line class.
We saw 58 Josh Outlaw get, I guess, credited for the sack.
Former offensive lineman. How about that?
Moved over.
Moved over last October, and Coach Kingsbury said the other day, Josh been one of the pleasant surprises. You look up at this defensive line, we come here 1 year from now, and tons of seniors right there, but Braden Fajoco, a signee we'll talk about, and a guy like Josh Outlaw will be the anchors of that interior, that defensive line next year.
So take a look at Cliff Kingsbury entering his third year as the head coach, and again, a good crowd here in Midland. Came out. We've got 10,000 plus. We heard from Dale Redmond, heard from Tim Culp, who helped put this thing together. So the offense will take over at about the 40-yard line. And there, again, you see how the head coach can kind of do it the way he wants, because all of a sudden you got great field position on the 40. After the defense again comes up with a stop. Mahomes over the head of DeAndre Washington.
Yeah, Mr. Reed right there looked like kind of floated that one up. And you talk to people around the program, they really praised Pat for how well he's taken care of the ball, how well he's managed trying to play baseball, still maintaining a 4.0 GPA and all that stuff. But probably not a good pass right there as he kind of floated that one up, almost got picked off.
Rick Levi with a lot of the pressure on that play. There's one. That one again almost picked off. Nigel Bethel on the break up there.
Yeah, nice play by Mr. Bethel.
A couple times we've seen a couple of near turnovers.
Yep, jumped the route right there. And Nigel, you know, again, that experience, the guys that you heard Tevin Madison talking about a second ago, but all that experience at those young corners, those freshman corners last year, it should pay off.
Mahomes with deep ball. That's intercepted.
And that's Micah Alway right
there. Alway.
Yep.
Guy we've heard a lot about all spring from all the coaches about who's impressive, and it's Alway.
And luckily for Pat, there's a flag on the play, so that one's not going to count against him, because when we get the head coach here on this telecast here at the end of this deal, he would have said, not real happy with the way Pat didn't take care of the football, but guess what?
He didn't have to worry about it.
We can get that eraser out and mark that one off the ledger, but he got a little lucky right there. A little advised pass right there, deep in coverage. Micah Alway dropping the coverage and picked it off.
Saw Pete Robertson applying a little pressure to Pat Mahomes on that previous play.
Yeah, Pete was an interesting story last year. 12 sacks, I think 14 and a half tackles for loss. I mean, really, but when you just couldn't stop the run, some of those numbers like that, they don't look as good. And I think David Gibbs really wants to maybe spread some of that out and not really rely on Pete so much.
DeAndre Washington on the carry. We're going to take a break. You're watching the Texas Tech spring game here on Texas Tech TV on Fox.
Coach
Coach Gibbs is really funny. He's like a really funny person. He'll like, you know, kind of like tell us what we're doing wrong, but at the same time, we'll laugh about it. I mean, for example, the last scrimmage, like me and Brandon Jackson got put on a butt, same exact play, and he just starts like, look at that. Like, what are we doing? Like, we can't do that. And it's like, he's putting us down, but it's to build us back up. We know it's not like him just being just, you know, mean for no reason, but it's like his style of just being it's just personality really is rubbing off on us, and it's making us have identity, you know, as we go on. And he respects us too. Like, he tells us exactly how it is, you know, if we're not performing well, or there's no like shady area at all. It's just straight up like, we need to do this and we're gonna get this done.
It's Mike Alway talking about his head coach. Jalen Barnes went down with the injury, Chris, and helped off the field. Hopefully that won't be too serious. I know you said he's had some problems with that leg before.
Yeah, that's the one bad thing about spring practice is, you know, you hate to see those kinds of things. But, you know, again, it's part of football, but hopefully he's okay. And I saw Cliff Kingsbury out there checking on him, and usually when head coach goes out there, the news may not be good, but hopefully we'll hope for the best for Jalen. And here in Micah, I mean, I think David Gibbs maybe is impressed with Micah Alway, now a senior, which is hard to believe, more than any player so far this spring on defense.
There's DeAndre Washington again trying to break it outside, but that's some good pursuit there by the Tech defense.
DeAndre Washington, the ball carrier.
Flag on the play right there, but
Keenan Ward, one of the guys there, in on the tackle.
Good pursuit by the defense, and yes, that's one of the things you really wanted to see today was that that defensive line. Lots of seniors now, lots of junior college guys that are in their second year, and inconsistent last year, gave up 260 yards a game on the ground and 35 rushing touchdowns, Robert, and that's just not something that is going to equal a successful season. And it was tough to watch, but that's why David Gibbs is here. And if those junior college guys will take that next step and in that rotation and all that, like you saw right there, and that's consistent, should have a much better year stopping the run.
So we're ready to go again. A little break in the action. Patrick Mahomes. Remember the last time we saw him through 598 yards and 6 touchdowns against Baylor. He's going to take it himself, and they'll blow that dead.
That's a called quarterback run. That's almost cheating.
Tevin Madison was right there.
When you can't tackle the guy in the red jersey.
Could have applied the hit, but he pulled up. Doesn't probably want to pay whatever penalty would come along with that.
I'm guessing lots of
Brandon Jackson also. They look like Jackson was like, come on, man.
There's some running or some steps or some early morning hours that would be involved with hitting anybody in a red jersey today if you're on defense.
And while we are seeing some scrimmage-type action, Chris, we do just need to write it. This is basically just a practice here for these guys. We're not treating it like a typical red and black in the past. Ball is knocked down.
Yeah, and again, it's not, you're just about halfway through here. So I think evaluations are continuing with this coaching staff and certain players and certain looks and all that. And, you know, if it doesn't necessarily look good for on defense today, I mean, David Gibbs just 8 practices in trying to install his stuff. Zach Spavital, new linebackers coach.
Pete Robertson in on the, again, looking from this angle. I thought Patrick had been knocked down. He kept it in his hand, but Robertson was in his face there.
Pump fake, yes. And he's just so good in the pocket with that, you know, just that awareness and moxie that, again, he can get somebody to bite. And, again, just keep that play alive, get him to, you know, extend it, because DBs can only cover guys for so long.
So now we're going to try a field goal.
And it's going to come right in your direction here, so I'll make sure Clayton Hatfield doesn't
48-yarder
kick it up your way. Let's
Look
hope
at
he
the
does.
Wind. I think with the wind, it might be a hard time to get it to where we are.
Yeah, it's wide right there.
Not even sure that Steve Austin, the Bionic Man, could get it to where we are right now in the wind. But
I thought Steve Austin was stone cold.
He could be that, too.
Oh, okay, got it.
It's age, generational difference there between us. $6 million man versus stone cold Steve Austin.
That's right.
So a missed field goal. We've had one touchdown on the pass from Patrick Mahomes to Dylan Cantrell. So Mahomes on his 3 possessions, it's resulted in a 3 and out, a touchdown pass, and then a missed field goal. So anything you can tell right now, notice differently from this Gibbs defense?
No, well, I think you like the pursuit right there. They seem to be swarming pretty good. You know, that used to be a moniker that the Texas Tech defense used when John Goodner was in charge of it. Guys like Monte Rager and all that stuff. But I think that's what you see just early on here. Just a nice, haven't given up too much. The one screen pass to Quentin White was a little leaky. Here is, that's either Quentin White or DeMarcus Felton. I can't tell which.
Okay. Shimonek handed that to Felton, and Felton broke it around the outside.
And I think they've been in position to make a few plays on the ball. I think you're talking about the defense. You know, you will hear David Gibbs say, I've been doing this a long time, and our guys in the secondary will be in a better position to make a play on the ball than they have in the past. So I think you've seen some of that so far today.
See the, I think a result maybe of some of the stripping techniques these guys are trying to use to force turnovers as the ball went on the ground after he was down. So coming right towards us now, Shimonek has a chance to lead the touchdown drive.
Working on a lot of the screen game today. That's one thing, too, that I think Coach Gibbs' scheme is going to, you'll see a lot of nickel that he'll employ, and you'll see them really play some bend but don't break because they do not want to get beat over the top. You haven't really seen Pat or Nick Shimonek try to go over the top at all yet.
Free play here for Shimonek. I believe the defense jumped off sides of the pass incomplete down in the end zone. A lot of whistles being blown from all sides as you see Michael Coley.
Yep, red shirt from last year. They signed him as played a little receiver in high school. Signed him as a corner, and now they're giving him a little bit of a look at safety. He's got some measurables there. He's about 6'3" or so, so may settle in the safety. And see, that's a guy like if Jalen Barnes is going to miss some time here in the next couple of weeks, Michael Coley will benefit from those extra reps. Like I said, let's hope Jalen Barnes not going to miss too much time.
And Jalen did leave. I mean, he had some assistance, but he was walking off. It looked like it might have been a lot worse than maybe. And, of course, you don't want to even begin to speculate. But Courtney's down on the field, so we'll see what she can find out. She can scoop around. That'll be the end of the quarter. So we will take a break. We are in Midland at Grande Communications Stadium. You're watching the Texas Tech Spring Game here on Texas Tech TV on Fox. Are we going to be in Texas Tech football spring game? We played a quarter. We've seen a touchdown drive engineered by Patrick Mahomes, Robert Giovanetti, and Chris Lovell. Now joined by Texas Tech Director of Athletics, Kirby Hocutt. Kirby, I like the look at the hat. You're looking all casual out here on a spring day.
Well, beautiful day in Midland, Texas. Great crowd, great atmosphere, so it's fun to be with you.
And we heard from Dale Redmond and a couple of the other guys here.
Tim Cole.
Yep. They really do a really good job of bringing something like this together.
Well, the whole Midland community is such an important part of our athletic program and our university. And I tell you, Tim Culp has been our quarterback and has taken this scrimmage and this event to a level beyond all of our expectations.
As we look again, the action on the field as they're starting the second quarter of play. And, you know, with what's happening at Jones Stadium, really has a, this is a nice alternative here because we can't be playing this in Jones Stadium right now.
Well, we can't, and we're so fortunate that we have tremendous support from the Lubbock community. And you know, we have $15 million of improvements taking place in Jones AT&T Stadium right now, and the seating bowl is under construction, and it's not possible for us to host an open practice scrimmage there. So this is the best alternative for us, and we appreciate the hospitality of this community.
And speak to Coach Kingsbury's program right now. I know didn't go to a bowl game, not the kind of season that anybody wanted, but hey, it all goes up from here, and I know everybody's excited, and stands are full behind us, and football, we're going to move past that and move forward.
Well, having the opportunity to live inside the four walls of Texas Tech football every day, Chris, you're exactly right. I could not be more optimistic about our future and the leadership of Coach Kingsbury and the staff that he's assembled, and the chemistry, the attitude in that program right now is extremely positive. These young men are working extremely hard. This is a very proud coaching staff and a coaching staff that's determined to get us back to the level that we all expect to be at, and that's competing for championships.
Michael Barton makes the field goal back there behind us. We have a missed field goal, and he made the field goal into the win. While we have Kirby Hocutt here, let's go back to the field. Courtney Davis has got an injury update.
Robert, Jalen Barnes will not return today. He's got a left leg injury. He's icing on the defensive sideline training table, but will not return today, but should hope to be okay in the weeks to come.
I guess that's another, thank you, Courtney. I guess that's another situation you don't want to take any chances, Kirby, right, with these guys. I mean, it's got a couple of weeks of spring left, and really it's more important in August.
Well, it's much more important in August, and you want to give the young guys as many looks as you can. You want to get the returning players as many reps, but you're always take every caution in the spring time, just like Courtney reported, and take your time, because this summer is when you win football games. This summer, your time spent in the weight room, your time spent around the guys, that's when you develop the camaraderie and the work ethic to win in the fall.
And tell me about the conversations you had with new defensive coordinator David Gibbs. I think you can talk shop with a guy like that. This is something that you played it in, obviously in college and all that, and you really think that he's got a lot that will benefit this football program.
I think Coach Kingsbury hit a grand slam with bringing Coach Gibbs on board, and I love what Coach Gibbs talks about. He's old school in a lot of ways when he talks about his philosophy, the fundamentals of defense, and I just think that he's going to bring that attitude, that continuity, that stability to that side of the ball that we desperately need. I couldn't be more excited that Coach Gibbs is a part of this program, and think he's going to be a tremendous fit for us.
And when he went for two in that bowl game, I thought this guy's going to fit in right here, because they won that bowl game, the University of Houston, and didn't have to go for two, but does it anyway. The kids win it, and the rest is history, and I think he fits in great from a chemistry standpoint with this coaching staff.
That was a fearless decision. I sat there and watched every snap of that bowl game that Houston played in, that Coach Gibbs was the interim head coach, and like you, Chris, like what I saw that afternoon.
Patrick Mahomes running the offense here for the Red Raiders. Kirby, you got to like the fact he's really obviously a very good quarterback. He's playing baseball as well, and a 4.0 GPA.
Patrick is...
throws a great deep ball, as we see right there. What a catch.
Great passing catch. He demonstrates what we want in all of our student athletes. He's a tremendous young man, a great athlete, and a lot of fun to watch.
Dylan Cantrell on the reception. Those two guys have a little bit of communication together.
Absolutely. Little White House to White House. And again, what he shows you right there with his ability to extend the play, it puts the defense on their heels. And
Patrick. They're going to call offensive interference on that? Yeah, they are going to call.
They caught Dylan with his hand in the cookie jar.
How about that, Kirby? It seems like you get a little home cooking here, for the offense. Instead, they call the offensive interference.
Yeah, I think Coach Gibbs is working those officials pretty good down there, isn't he?
I think Coach Kingsbury is going to have to maybe readdress this at halftime with the officials.
And Kirby, explain. You know, when you were a college football player, explain how some of these scrimmages work, because there's certain things that, like, say, David Gibbs may not be allowed to do. Hey, we're not going to blitz today. You're not going to do this. Explain kind of how that works from a player standpoint.
Well, the coaches have a philosophy on what they're trying to look at today, Chris, and you're exactly right. This is a scripted scrimmage. So the offensive coaches and the defensive coaches are putting each side of the ball in certain situations so they can evaluate players in certain scenarios. So it's scripted, but I tell you what, there's a lot of bragging rights that are out there on that field, and there's going to be a lot of pride that's out there, and some trash talking too on that bus ride back home today.
Yeah, I see a lot of yapping on the field right now between the two units, and so that's good. It's obviously a lot of competition going on right now.
Yeah, it's a competitive game. It's a physical game, and you definitely want those bragging rights going into practice next week.
Nice catch there by Ian Sadler on the sideline.
And Kirby, you're going to be really busy in the fall with the speak to your new role on the College Football Playoff Committee. It's one of the highest honors, I think, of any AD in the country right now.
Well, I'm looking forward to participating with such an esteemed group and being a part of a program, a college football playoff that has quickly become one of the most popular sporting events in our country, and participate in my first meetings this coming week in Indianapolis, and looking forward to meeting and working with that great group.
So we saw Sadler with a couple of receptions. That one busted loose. Is that Justin Stockton?
Yeah, we're in number four this year, and guess what? He's fast.
He's very fast. Boy, he hit that hole, and he burst that open. It's good. You get a lot of guys. You know, we talk a lot about the passing game here, but we've seen Stockton and DeAndre Washington, Quentin White, all making a difference as well.
Deep, deep group of running backs.
I like the way, Kirby, that just Patrick handles himself, and I know you really stressed that with our student-athletes. He really, as you see Stockton break another tackle. So nice play there by Stockton, but Mahomes, the way he carries himself and represents the university, I know you like that as well.
Well, Patrick's a leader in every sense. You mentioned his 4.0 GPA, and he is a student-athlete and does a tremendous job balancing playing two sports, and he's going to head out of here today and get back in the dugout with our Red Raider baseball team against Kansas this afternoon and tomorrow. But Patrick's a leader, and we're very proud of him.
Completes another pass, another great.
Jakeem Grant.
We've seen that before out of Grant. And that's the second touchdown pass of the afternoon and a touchdown for the offense, the number one offense here, the second of the afternoon.
And that'll please Coach Kingsbury. That's a very efficient drive right there with some of your playmakers highlighting it with Justin Stockton and Jakeem Grant.
So get two touchdowns, a field goal and a missed field goal for the offense this afternoon in the first half of action. Of course, second half will run with the clock not stopping. We get the extra point. And so we will take a break. Again, you are watching from Grande Communications Stadium in Midland, the Texas Tech Spring.
Davis are doing well. Davis has come back from his injury, obviously, and Patrick's through baseball. So, I mean, they kind of have things that are, I don't know how to put it into words, but they both have distractions, I guess you could say. Davis can't do full contact. Patrick has to worry about baseball at the same time. So it's going to be a great competition through the spring in camp.
Got some stats here so far. 7 plays, 96-yard drive for that touchdown. Mahomes is 6 for 10 for 79 yards, touchdown. Shows an interception, but I believe that interception was called back, was it not?
Yeah, I believe that was a penalty on that play, but
a deep pass out of the end zone over the head of everyone.
You know, when you hear Cliff Kingsbury talk about Nick Szymanek, and I think he really made some strides when he was on campus last fall, got some practice time, obviously had to sit out because of transfer, but in terms of quarterback play, Cliff will say, hey, man, a kid can really spin it and obviously really, really throw it. Just need some reps, like we said, just need some learn more opportunities to learn in this offense. He misses a throw right there, but again, throwing it down the field and making all the throws, certainly something he can do. He just, again, needs some more experience.
You know, guys like Szymanek can really take advantage of, you know, he's the ultimate winner in this, right, with Mahomes?
Probably. Missing some time because of baseball. And Davis Webb, who has, you know, Davis has been practicing some, but he just, like some of the live situations in a situation like today with the scrimmage, they're going to hold him out. They're going to be careful with him because of that his shoulder surgery he had with that torn labrum last year. And it's killing a guy like Davis, too. This is not what he envisioned, and they knew he had to get that shoulder fixed. But he is, and you'll hear from Davis Webb again.
That might have been a situation there where if Szymanek hadn't been wearing the red jersey, it might have been a safety, but he's able to escape, and we saw Outlaw again almost saying, hey, what more do I got to do? So he hands off, I believe that's to Felton.
Yeah, I don't care who you are, if you're Pete Robertson or whatever, insert senior name here, you're not going to win that battle with the officials or with the coaching staff when it comes to what you can and cannot do to a quarterback in this setting.
It's like Taylor Nunez on the tackle. A lot of new faces up and down the roster, especially on that second team offensive line, Chris. And again, I know that depth of the offensive line is a bit of a concern.
Yeah, it's just
looked like Brendan Fajoco in on the.
Yeah, Braden, one of the most highly touted signees that has come into this program in a long time. And obviously Mike Smith recruited that prospect. And obviously, you know, his brother VJ played last year. And Sam was in this program as well, still is, as a graduate assistant on defense. But nice to see Braden finally here.
Zach Barnes also in on that stop. Barnes, 6'2", 230, sophomore on that defensive line. So Szymanek, again, back to pass. A little pressure being applied. Breaks loose, nice block in the backfield. Again, a deep pass. And yeah. Cantrell was there, but overthrown just a bit.
Nice athleticism right there to get out of the pocket. And that's one thing about Dylan. His skill set doesn't really allow him to get behind the defense much, but when you extend the play like that, he can go up and get it. And, you know, saw that play a little while ago with Pat Mahomes. They called interference on it, but just throw it up. Trust your guy.
Keshawn Allen back, one of the defenders back on that. I tell you, Nunez has also been, I thought, very active that last possession.
Taylor is one of those just great teammates. You know, he played a lot in that Baylor game at the end of the season. A lot of injuries and things dictated, you know, and really hurt your depth. And they really leaned on a guy like Taylor Nunez a lot. Mike Smith did when he was the interim DC back as the season was finishing up. But Taylor, do whatever you ask him.
Well, and you mentioned this in, I think, in your conversation with Coach Gibbs earlier this week. They're going to play a lot of guys on the defensive line.
That's what his philosophy is. Even if some of the guys at the back end of that rotation aren't that good, to be blunt, he just feels like you get more out of your better guys by resting them. And he said that's just something I've learned over doing this for about 25 years. Is you just have to have a rotation and commit yourself to it. Now some guys will play more than others, but and I think he believes that in a lot of the spots on defense.
So Mahomes back in, hands it off to Washington. Washington breaks a couple tackles, gets down to about the 30.
Boy, how much fun was it to watch, you know, in a season that was really tough on this football program and tough for these players, fans, everybody, but seeing DeAndre Washington really have some success individually and go over 1,000 yards there in Ames, Iowa, add to that there in Arlington versus Baylor, fun to watch.
Coming out of the backfield, Washington inside the 15. He's a guy I think you're going to really count on a lot. Here in 2015.
Bread and butter equals DeAndre Washington, especially let's run left. You know, I mean, when you've got an all-league left tackle and LaRaven Clark, man, that's really the bread and butter of this football team right now.
And here he is again getting a steady dose. He breaks down inside the five.
And the best thing, honestly, for DeAndre was that you have guys like Justin Stockton enter the program. It makes a guy like DeAndre get that much better. You talk to Mike Jinks, who coaches that position. He said, you know, DeAndre handled it great, but I think he felt some of those young bucks kind of breathing down his neck, and it benefited everybody.
So Pete Robertson on that tackle.
Pete will be one of those guys like many of these. Oh, sorry, Robert. Pete will be one of those guys like many seniors that different defensive coordinator every single year they were here.
Yeah, it's they play for a lot of different guys. Nice job by Keelan there getting in the backfield and disrupting that play. Another guy I think would be key heading into next year. Well, of course, you put any guy with a DL by his name is going to be a key next year. There's another designed run.
Patrick Mahomes stopped by number 99, Rico Levy.
I'm going to try a field goal here. I'll be interested to see how many more series Pat gets. They've scored a couple of times.
See Eric Morrison, Cliff Kingsbury. Cliff Kingsbury talking to Patrick. See Davis Webb standing there as well. Field goal is good. That's our second field goal of the afternoon. We'll take a break. You're watching the spring game here in Midland, Texas Tech TV on Fox. Welcome back to Grande Communications Stadium on Midland, Texas. The spring game moved down south with all the renovations. $15 million in renovations at Jones AT&T Stadium back on the campus of Texas Tech University.
Yeah, I think when people see Jones AT&T Stadium after it's done, it's really going to pop. A lot of that new seating and all that concrete being redone and retreated and everything like that is really going to look good. And some work being done at the north end of the stadium, north end zone.
There's your man Felton again with the carry.
You know what? He is my man. I'll take that.
Barden got the field goal at the end of that last drive, and I believe the clock is just going to keep running out, Chris, and we may have seen the last of Patrick Mahomes. We're still checking on that, but I think that may be the case.
Well, you want a young man like that to have some success, especially in front of these fans and whatnot, and obviously the touchdown pass to Jakeem Grant might be a nice way to exit stage left, as it would be. So it could be Nick Szymanek's show the remainder of the way, and a young man by the name of Payne Sullins out of Waco, Texas, will come in here and get some reps here in a little bit.
We did see Davis Webb on the sideline standing there by Patrick Mahomes. Or you can see Davis again over there roaming the sidelines and just being held out for cautionary measures?
You know, and it's worth mentioning, I think there was two schools in the Big 12 last year that went through their entire conference slate. I think it was Kansas State and TCU that only played one quarterback all the way through, and then Trevon Boykin and Jake Waters. And so, you know, when you start looking at who's going to be the starting quarterback or who's how this is going to look and whatnot, you're going to need both of these guys, folks. I mean, the odds are, you know, somebody gets hurt, there's some inefficiency here or there. I mean, that's just, you're lucky that you're in a position where you have two guys that have, heck, man, set records. one for, what, Cowboy Stadium in Arlington, the other one there in a Holiday Bowl, and, you know.
Okay, we got a quarter break.
All right, so we're going to take another break as you see Barden coming out. Looks like they're going to do a little special teams. So we'll take a break. We'll be back after this. You're watching Texas Tech TV on Fox.
We're going to run some special teams.
We're back at Grande Communication Stadium in Midland, Texas. It's the Texas Tech spring game. Robert Giovanetti alongside of Chris Lovell. Chris, first half, I feel almost silly saying first half because it's just a controlled scrimmage, controlled practice.
It's scripted even.
It's even scripted.
Okay.
So, yes. So, but you can pick some things out of that. I like what we saw Patrick Mahomes. I liked what we saw DeAndre Washington. And I like that you mentioned this earlier, kind of a swarming aspect of the defense.
Yeah, I think you saw some of the defensive guys make some plays on the football in certain situations. I think that, again, that's when you're talking about David Gibbs, and I know Courtney will do that in just a little bit. It's all about turnovers and creating turnovers, creating havoc, and trying to get the offense to do what they want you to do. But you also see guys like DeAndre Washington and Justin Stockton and guys like that. Jakeem Grant with a nice play. Some of your usuals stepping up and making some plays on offense.
Well, I could ask you this whole period who you liked on defense, but we could go back to the man, Coach Dave Gibbs. Let's go down back to the field with Courtney. She's got Coach Gibbs.
Coach Gibbs, not a bad first half for you guys. You really caused some havoc in the backfield, had some pass breaks ups, and had an interception taken away. How would you assess your play?
You know, the kids are playing hard. You know, this is our ninth practice, and the kids have gotten better each and every time out, you know, putting in a new system, learning new terminology, learning everything. And then, again, going against Coach Kingsbury and Coach Morris and that offense every day is war out there. And, you know, they took the ball down the field, two long drives, which isn't acceptable. But kids are playing hard, and we'll learn from the mistakes as we watch the film.
You're definitely seeing a difference in the pursuit, and that's something you've really harped upon all spring long, is get to the football, create some chaos, that causes turnovers.
It does, and the kids, they do play hard. You know, you have to play hard and play smart at the same time. Like you said, a little disappointed. We had the one turnover got taken back because of a penalty. Obviously, we're focusing on not having as many penalties as we did last year. At the same time, it's not an excuse. We got to try to get the football away from our offense. But the truth is, all spring, they've done a great job protecting the football. So we got to keep grinding, and hopefully we'll get some turnovers here in the second half.
A couple of young guys the fans are obviously getting their first look at today. Braden Fajoco, Mike Mitchell, seeing a lot of time as well.
They are. Both young men have had a really good spring so far. Braden obviously should still be in high school, is getting ready for his prom. He's actually showed up here last couple practices. Not that he wasn't playing hard and good early, but it's hard to make that adjustment from high school to college. And then Mike obviously has been, you know, he hadn't played real football in 2 years. So all this action out here is great for him, and he'll continue to get better.
You got a couple weeks after this scrimmage to wrap up spring ball. What are you hoping to get out of it before you head into summer workouts and obviously fall camp later on?
You know, solidify the depth chart, solidify the guys who we're going to count on to play next year, and continue to build to build and install the defense. We probably put in about half our defense already, and we're trying to go slow. First, you know, you want to teach it at a slow pace, but our offense goes so fast that it's hard to put in too much because you'll end up making mistakes every play. So continue to install the defense, and at the same time look for the depth chart to be solidified here in the next six practices.
The hype around Texas high school football and Texas football in general is nothing new to you, but your first experience here in Midland in the Permian Basin.
Crazy. I tell you what, you know, we're used to practicing in Lubbock in front of about 25 people, so this is awesome. It's great for the kids, it's great energy, and it's great for Texas Tech.
Thanks, Coach. I appreciate it. I'll let you get back to your team.
Thank
you. Robert, back to you.
Thanks, Courtney. And it's funny, Coach Gibbs said, you know, because the practices have been closed, so this is a little bit different atmosphere. You go from, hey, just a handful of people, maybe people you know, some of your faculty members, you know, some of the admin guys come over. Now you got 10,000, 12,000 people watching you.
Yeah, and, you know, Coach Gibbs has been around this thing for a long time, but it's just nice to get him out here in West Texas and see what it's like in Friday Night Lights territory. How about that? But, you know, so much of what we'll discuss with him in the coming weeks and practices and all that stuff and months with the offseason has to do with the turnover. And, you know, there's an old adage that coaches use to say, you're good at what you emphasize. I'm not certain there's anybody in the country that emphasizes it more than this guy. It was a way of life at the University of Houston. He wants it to be a way of life here at Texas Tech, and hopefully he's here for a long time.
All right, we got a lot more to go here from Midland. We'll have Cliff Kingsbury up here with us in just a little while talking about what he saw on the field this afternoon, but we'll go to break. You're watching Texas Tech TV on Fox. Looking at Raider Red, he made the trip down here. Not just resting on his accolades from the national championship that he won a year and a half or so ago. He's down here entertaining the fans in Midland. Robert Giovanetti and Chris Lovell, we're not entertaining the fans. We're over here tucked away in the corner. But it's been a good turnout here in Midland. We've seen a lot of good football. They're doing some special teams drills right now on the field. Let's go back to Courtney on the field.
That it's something a lot of times the general public will take notice of, but you know, for 3 years, the holder for the special teams was Ryan Erkslaven, and the consistency and the records that were broken by Ryan Buston, who holds the all-time record for field goals in a season, as well as extra points and points made. However, last year, it was Bradley Marquez, Mr. Do-It-All. He was on special teams. He was your receiver. He did just about everything. He was also your holder, and at times you saw some missed field goals just because that timing is so crucial between the holder and the kicker. Now this year you're going to see another, as Marquez obviously is trying to make his name in the NFL draft. Cameron Batson has taken those snaps, trying to get his timing down with whether it's Taylor Semenk, Michael Barden, or Clayton Hatfield, and that's something you would hope would carry on, as Cameron Batson's one of those young guys, and the repetition and the solidifying of that position is crucial for games that are won and lost at the field goal line or at the extra point line.
All right, thank you, Courtney, for that. And, of course, Bradley Marquez from this area.
Yes, he is. I believe he's in the house today. And, you know, to Courtney's point, is there anything more, you know, that unnerves, you know, a coach in general than a punt returner? You know, especially when you're a true freshman punt returner. And when you trot out Cameron Batson as a true freshman punt returner last year, hey, dude, go field it, okay, in front of 80,000. And sometimes we're going to ask you to catch it, and just don't drop it. And he did that, I think, a great job of it last year. And I think no secret right there as to why he would be maybe a guy that could transition into holder right there.
Okay, I think the special teams drills are over, so we'll come back and have your second half of action here at Grande Communications Stadium in Midland. You're watching the Texas Tech Spring Game here on Texas Tech TV on Fox. Stadium here in Midland, Texas. The whole family made the trip down, even the family pet.
Yeah, they did.
A little harder to feed than just like your average schnauzers, whatever dog. But Fearless is here. Robert Giovanetti and Chris Lovell here. Spring game. Just getting ready to start the second half of action. And it'll be, you know, the first half was a little bit frenetic just because, you know, scripted and very, you know, just a lot of things that we couldn't really see from where we are. The second half will probably just blow by.
Yeah, it will. You'll see a running clock. And a lot of this has to do with, there's just not enough linemen in camp right now to really, you know, get much out of it. I mean, you have one offensive lineman that's playing second team right now. He's in his third college practice ever. Okay, so, and he, you know, as Coach Hayes just told me a while ago, hey, man, I've just even quit yelling. It doesn't really help at some point. But, again, these kids are doing the best they can. But it kind of messes up what you're trying to do on offense. And you're putting a lot of those guys in on defense that can overmatch some of these young offensive linemen. So, you know, they'll do the best they can with it.
We heard Coach Gibbs talk about Braden Fehoko. That's a guy that should be, like you said, be getting ready for prom.
Yes, he should. And I tell you what, if you see Braden Fehoko in the weight room, that is a grown man. And typically when you see these high school prospects coming in, that's the one thing that it takes him a few years to really get acclimated from a strength standpoint, but not Braden. He just needs to learn, you know, his hand placement and all the scheme and all everything like that. But as far as strength goes, yeah, it ought to be fun to watch.
All right, let's go back to the field. I believe Patrick Mahomes is back out here for the second
half.
And so I think he's going to get an advantageous position, too. It looks like they're starting at the inside the 10-yard line.
Yeah, maybe you want to see a little goal line and red zone stuff right here, and maybe Coach Kingsbury got a little more he wants to see out of his starting quarterback. So two touchdowns wasn't enough. I believe Pat was 12 of 16 in that first portion of the scrimmage.
Tried a little option there. You talked about, we saw that earlier in the first half when he threw the pass. Derek Dixon was there on defense thinking about applying the hit, and then he backed off.
Derek Dixon, another one of those young safeties that got a lot of action last year, and hopefully it benefits him as David Gibbs now in charge of the secondary, obviously the defense in general, but really a lot of youth in that secondary that hopefully the lumps that they took last year will pay some dividends going forward.
Flag on the play. Don't see what they've called.
And you know, a guy we haven't talked about too, we talked about the offensive line some. Boy, Justin Murphy, right there, number 73, right there at right tackle. A lot of expectations for that young man, redshirted last year. They almost played him several times last season, but maintained that redshirt. But he is going to be expected to be your starting right tackle with these other four starters, as you have one of the most experienced offensive lines in the conference.
Up the middle.
Justin Stockton with a touchdown right there.
Justin Stockton scores the third touchdown of the afternoon. So the ones offense, again, the very nice job there from the 10-yard line. Good starting point.
And it kind of tricks you because it looks like you're watching Bradley Marquez run through the middle of the line as he wore number four for 4 years in this football program. But, again, Justin Stockton now wearing that single digit. And speaking of Bradley Marquez, we'll be talking to him shortly.
Yes, he's down on the field with Courtney as we see Clayton Hatfield back out for the extra point attempt. And it is true through the middle, and so a nice offensive drive there of 10 yards. You'd like to have that 10-yard starting position every time if you're Cliff Kingsbury. Let's go back to the field. Courtney does have Bradley Marquez.
Bradley, it's got to be a bit different this year. Usually it's a homecoming for you. You've got the most fans in the stands when we come to Midland. Now you are the fan in the stands.
Yeah, it's definitely different for me. Being my partaking in watching a Texas Tech football game for the first time in 4 years is kind of crazy to me, and it's still kind of surreal, but everybody's time has to come to an end at some point, but it's just good to be back, good to see him in my hometown, and always good to have the spring game here.
I've seen you on the sideline talking to some of the guys, coaching them up a bit. What have you thought so far?
Oh, they're doing great. I mean, it's a typical spring. You know, there's going to be ups and downs here and there. But, guys are growing up at this time period. And, like you said, just talking to some of the young guys, I haven't talked to them in a while and just, chatting it up with them and, seeing how they're doing and helping them out whenever they have any questions. But, it's just fun to be out here. I'm glad to be around here. I mean, Texas Tech is my home, so I'm just glad to be around.
One of them, Patrick Mahomes, you were drafted out of high school to the New York Mets. You would report in the summer, play for them, and then come back and be a Red Raider and play football. Pat's trying to do both this spring. He's playing for the baseball team. He's playing football, and he's a 4.0 kid. How do you manage both? What is that mindset like?
No, I absolutely commend him. I mean, it's definitely tough. I mean, me doing it personally, a little bit different.
You're
but
only out of the 2 months out of the year.
Yeah, and mine was only 2 months out of the year, exactly. And he's doing it, right now through the entire spring, and especially with the great baseball team that we have, and the amount of time that it takes to be that. But I think the biggest thing is just balancing school with it all. I commend him for doing that, because when I was playing baseball in the summer, I wasn't doing any kind of school. It was just all focused on baseball at the time. And so for him to do school, football, and baseball at the same time, I mean, I commend him. But he's a great guy, and he can handle it. So he's a good dad to do it.
There's a chance you'll have the opportunity to do both again as you continue forward. You've got the NFL draft coming up in a couple months, and then you've possibly got a baseball free agency contract on your mind as well. We'll stick to football, though. Pro day, big success for you. 4.48 40, I think you've got to be happy with that.
Oh, absolutely. I had a great day, and for me, it was just all the hard work throughout the training. I mean, it was a 10-week process that I went through in San Diego, and it all paid off. I mean, it's kind of hard to gauge. You get nervous. You're prepared for it, but at the same time, I mean, you get the butterflies because you only have one day to show yourself really to all these scouts. So, I ended up having a great day. So, I mean, I was happy with it. Thank God I had a great day, and, hopefully see what happens in the future. I have no control over it, and, I did everything I could do thus far, and, it's going to sit and wait and, put it in God's hands.
What will be the next few weeks look like for you moving forward? You're still in West Texas, hanging out between Odessa and Lubbock.
Oh yeah, I'll be in. I'm mainly in Lubbock. I've been working out the facility, you know, with some of the guys as well, like Kenny. You know, guys that are going into the draft. So we've just been working out with each other and just, you know, just at the facility, still around these guys a little bit, and it's just good to be around. I mean, they've been welcoming and, you know, just still letting us be around the facilities and the weight room and all that. And so, I mean, it's just fun. I mean, it's a fun process right now. I mean, it's kind of, you know, it's just sit and wait right now. I mean, we just got to work out, be in shape and ready to go whenever our name's called.
Well, we're sure going to miss you, but we can't wait to see what's to come. Thanks, Bradley. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Guys, we'll send it back to you.
Thank you, Courtney. It's Clayton Hatfield with the field goal. It is good. We come back. We'll talk about, you know, some other former players who are still hanging around the facility as well. We'll do that. We'll come back after these messages. You're watching Texas Tech TV on Fox. Half of Action Clock is continuing. Ron Play is continuing as we take breaks and talk to guests. Robert Giovanetti and Chris Level here with you. Chris, we heard from Bradley Marquez about hanging around, getting ready for pro day, or obviously not pro day, but the draft. And a great Red Raider that you've seen recently at the football training facility.
Well, yeah, because you hear Bradley, you know, talk about he and Kenny, guys like that, that I think have a legitimate shot to either be drafted or be undrafted free agents and get into a program. And, you know, a guy that's been hanging around and had a lengthy career in the NFL. Sammy Morris, well, bumped into him the other day, a longtime Miami Dolphin, New England Patriot, and been sitting in on team meetings and I think talking to running backs. And I'm guessing Kenny Williams and guys like Bradley Marquez have bent Sammy Morris's ear. And how about Sammy played in Cliff Kingsbury's first start? You know, so it's that was a running back for Texas Tech back in those late 90s, early 2000s were, you know, geez, he would have really, really excelled in these spread offenses of today. Is that he had a, what, 10, 12-year career in the NFL, being that kind of third-down type of back. But great to see Sammy the other day, and he's a guy that looks like he can still play.
Stockton, just his explosiveness. I mean, you get that two-headed monster you have with Stockton and Washington. Gives you a lot of high expectations for the running game next year.
Yeah, and Robert, what you like seeing, I think some of his runs have been in between the tackles.
Yeah.
Today.
Mahomes looks like he might get his third touchdown.
And Reginald Davis there.
Of the afternoon, Reginald Davis.
Patrick Mahomes pass complete. Number 6, Devin Lauderdale.
Oh, Devin Lauderdale.
Devin Lauderdale. He's at the other end of the field there. My eyes deceive me.
And also, there are 400 people on the sidelines. And blocking the view at this point, half of them.
And I'm not certain that anybody had any better end of the season last year than Devin Lauderdale. You know, he finishes up with 31 catches, 7 touchdowns, and a long of 82. How about that? I mean, he was your big play guy, your home run hitter, if you will. And it's been a while in this program that you've had a guy like Devin Lauderdale that could get behind the defense. But those play action fakes right there coming to play with a guy like Devin, because he can certainly run.
You surprised we've seen Mahomes as much as we have here in the second half?
I am. I think at some point on Thursday afternoon they made the decision, they being Tim Tadlock and Cliff Kingsbury, to go ahead and leave Pat here with the football team today. And at some point, Pat will get back, you know, today in Lubbock and try to rejoin baseball. They start first pitch 2 o'clock there versus Kansas. But I just think that everybody felt like he was better served by staying here and being around his teammates and all that. So I think that's why you're seeing him a little bit longer. But surprised that we've seen him play as much as we have, yes. And a lot of the starters on offense, I think, have played a lot longer than we thought.
Yeah, we've got the one still out there right now for the offense. And, you know, baseball has to have in Big 12 play, a 27-man roster for the weekend. Patrick is not on that. He can dress and be, you know, on the field and the dugout and everything with the team, but he is not part of the official 27-man roster this weekend for baseball.
Yeah, and, you know, and with baseball, he's going through fall ball right now, essentially. You know, all those guys on that team, you know, went through their fall ball and back in, you know, September, October, and that situation. And so he's kind of working through some of that right now. But he has really played well in football this spring so far and taking care of the football. You've seen some of that extension of what he did at the end of last season on display today. It's been fun to watch.
And we saw some video there of him throwing under the tutelage of Ray Hayward. There's really not a better guy to learn pitching from than Ray Hayward. So you got to feel good about that, Pat, with Ray Hayward. It looks like, is that Payne Sullins in now?
Yeah, you have Payne Sullins in now. And Interesting thing about Payne Sullins is that that Texas game last year in Lubbock, Texas, that primetime affair, Payne Sullins was one play away from stepping foot on the field as your starting quarterback because when obviously Pat went out, that hit from Quandre Diggs of the University of Texas, and Vincent Testaverde Jr. had to come in. You know, at some point, okay, who's the backup to a guy like Vincent Testaverde? It would have been Payne Sullins.
Sullins, a freshman out of Gatesville, and so, as you mentioned, didn't come in, so he does get the red shirt. And again, he's another guy getting probably a lot more reps this this spring than he might have otherwise with the quarterback situation as it is. Felton has been a guy. They're not statting Chris this second half, so they just statted the first half. But as you look at some of Felton's stats from the first half, and you were high on him early. Matter of fact, we misidentified him.
We gave him credit for a lengthy screen pass that went to Quentin White.
So some stats from the first half. Mahomes was 12 of 16. Two touchdown passes for 169 yards. Felton carried it six times for 31 yards in the first half. Stockton, three carries for 20 yards. He just had a big game as well. Washington, six carries for 18 yards. Sadler had three catches. Cantrell had two catches and a touchdown. Grant had one catch, one being a 38-yard touchdown pass. And so you look throughout that. Felton had one catch in the first half as well for 5 yards. Wilson on the catch there.
And you've got Braden Fajoco in the game right now. We're talking about him a while ago, and he's also wearing that number four. That's got to be the biggest number four in the country.
Yes, he's
right there on the interior of that defensive line.
His size is so much different than what you expect from his brothers.
Yes. I'm trying to remember the last interior defensive lineman that wore a single digit for Texas Tech. I mean, Aaron Hunt wore number 9. He was more of a defensive end, but you just don't see that much with that big giant D tackle wearing a single digit right there. But it looks kind of not used to seeing it.
Cameron Batson is a pass just a little wide as he dove for that. So Sullins with the incomplete pass.
I think Batson has been a little inconsistent so far this spring, trying to figure out. I think Zach Austin and J.D. on High, guys like that, have had really good springs. But Batson's still trying to figure it out, but really making his money when it comes to special teams and being a holder and punt returner and all that stuff.
Sullins takes a page as he's brought down by Mike Mitchell. And Mitchell's a guy we heard Gibbs talking about in the at halftime as well.
Yeah, you know, Robert, I mean, a little rusty. I think you heard Coach Gibbs say, man, he hadn't played a game in 2 years. And so that takes a toll on a little bit. But you're talking about a guy that averaged, what, 18 tackles a game back in high school?
Yes.
I mean, I think, actually, you can make this statement about Mike Mitchell. He is as highly sought after of a prospect in any sport that has ever stepped foot on campus at Texas Tech. I mean, he had all the accolades and went to Ohio State before transferring here.
We're going to take a break here during the spring game at Midland at Grande Communications Stadium. You're watching Texas Tech TV on Fox. Back at Grande Communications Stadium in Midland, wrapping up the Texas Tech spring game. Robert Giovanetti and Chris Lovell here with you. One of the storylines has been the Texas Tech offensive line, LaRaven Clark coming back. Let's go back to the field. Courtney has more on that.
Yeah, Robert, one of the biggest question marks coming out of the 2014 season was obviously whether or not LaRaven would decide to go ahead and forgo his senior year and enter the NFL draft or come back. And I talked to Coach Hayes and LaRaven at length. So season, and LaRaven, he's so shy, he's such a quiet leader, but he is the anchor of that offensive line. And Coach Hayes says what's to watch is this spring taking control of that offense when is going to come back or not. He said it wasn't even a decision to the entire ready to leave. Chase said it was an early
Christmas. Thank you, Courtney, and again, glad to have LaRaven Clark. We had some technical difficulties there with Courtney's mic, but it's good to have LaRaven back, and he's going to be a leader on that offensive line.
Well, I mean, you can make the argument. It's, you know, that the spot that he plays is one of the most important on any football team, and obviously with LaRaven, I mean, he has been as good at that position as anybody in the Big 12 in the last season plus, and he'll be a preseason all-conference player, you know, this summer and heading into this season as he was last year, and just really, you know, a tremendous athlete, and you'll hear his name called in that NFL draft about 1 year from now. But I know Lee Hayes couldn't have been more excited about, and you look at something like 150 starts between this group of offensive linemen that are back with Castor and Alfredo Morales and LaRaven Clark and Baylen Brown, who is obviously missing this spring. Those guys have played a lot of football together. And you know, we haven't talked a lot about Jared Castor, but you know, that's another thankless position there at center, and he's done a great job with that. Hard to believe some of these guys are seniors, but you know, to Courtney's point, really, really glad that for Texas Tech football that I know Patrick Mahomes and Davis Webb and guys like that are really glad.
No doubt. You know, you talk about, you mentioned Mitchell before we went to break in the last possession. And you look at Mitchell, and you know, we don't know what we're going to get out of Mitchell. He's a guy that's probably, as you mentioned, a little rusty, and you know, he's transferred in. And but if he lives up to his hype, and you look at Mitchell and Fajoco both being on the defense, and those are a couple of pretty hyped guys that you can build your defense around.
And there's no question. The thing about Mike is he loves football. I mean, he is every bit of 6'3", about 230, 235, and just loves being around the game. Fairly quiet. You may see him on campus riding a skateboard around. He's just kind of a different guy, but he just loves being around the game. And he's somebody that I think that last year in those Thursday practices when they let a lot of the scout team and redshirt guys, I mean, he's just tearing it up. They almost had to tell him to calm down. But he'll get it figured out, and you'll hear from him this fall. There's no doubt about that.
Sullen's getting a lot of time here in the second half of action at the quarterback position. I would guess now for sure we will not see Patrick Mahomes the rest of the afternoon. I believe the clock is, we can't see it from our position, but almost less than a minute left now here in this second half of action on this practice down here in Midland. And so overall impressions as we wrap up?
Well, I think that the one thing is you hate seeing the Jalen Barnes injury.
Right.
That's somewhat frustrating.
And that kind of puts a damper on that thing early, doesn't it? Because then you might start thinking, okay, we don't want to have too much of this happen today.
Right. But you did see the you know, a lot of these offensive guys stay in a little bit longer than we would have thought. But, yeah, that's the one thing, you know, the takeaway. You don't want to see any of that. But really like seeing what Pat did. I think the running game was there. You like seeing some of these guys on defense make some plays on the ball. And all that, but that's going to wrap it up right there as Payne Sullins gets about, 10 snaps or so, and that's going to be it.
That's it. And we didn't stat the second half, so we can't give you any of that second half statistical information. We come back, I believe we'll have the head coach join us here on the set. We'll have some other interviews as well. You're watching the spring game here, Texas Tech TV on Fox. See Cliff Kingsbury addressing his team after the practice here at the spring game.
Yeah, and one thing that you heard him say, to his team a second ago, just proud of your effort. I think you guys played hard. And
great enthusiasm is one of the things he mentioned.
Absolutely. And that's really what you want out of a coach. And I think there was times last year maybe you didn't see that all the way through a game like you needed to, and trying to rectify that.
Hey, kudos to the folks here down in the Permian Basin. It's a great atmosphere, a big turnout. Of course, the weather was perfect. They didn't have much to do with that, but the weather's perfect. A little windy, but it kept it a little cooler. But the folks came out, and they supported it, and this is why you keep coming back every year.
Yeah, 10 to 12,000 people, I believe, was the estimate that we heard. And I know about 10,000 here last year, so they continue to build on that every year. But it's a fun day in Midland every spring, third year in a row, and I'm not certain that this will be the last one.
I think the head coach is sprinting his way up here right now. So as we get ready to have Cliff Kingsbury join us here in the post game to talk about what he saw today, we can mention all we want about what he saw and what we heard him say, but we're about to hear from him himself as we're going to do a little live television right on the air. So he's going to walk right up here to us right now. This way. All right, we're going to toss it down the field to Courtney.
DeAndre, a good day here in Midland. You guys really got to see some stuff on offense. How would you feel like the team overall performed?
I definitely think we made some strides today. Coach Gills made it pretty hard for the run game, but we got some good looks and we was able to make some plays.
You got a stable of running backs. You're the old man in the group now.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I'm the old head now, you know, but we definitely have a stable. I really feel we have the best, you know, best backfield in the Big 12.
What is it that you all bring to the table differently? We've seen Justin and his speed. You have become the all-purpose back, but Q broke that huge run with his, I mean, we don't like to give him his spin, but his spin.
I just think everybody, I mean, each every one of us, like, we just bring something a little bit different. Whether it's speed, whether it's agility, whether it's catching the ball, I mean, each one of us brings something different to the table. I think that's what makes us the best backfield.
Before I let you get out of here, as a leader on this football team coming off of last season, what has been your biggest message in the locker room throughout these practices?
You know, just get rid of that taste last year. I mean, we're motivated this whole offseason. I mean, you know, the way things went last year is just, trying to get back out there and get our feet back wet. But, you know, we're ready. We know we have the team to do it. It's just about putting it together now.
We're going to send it back upstairs to Coach Kingsbury and the guys.
All right, thank you, Courtney. We're now joined by Cliff Kingsbury himself. Coach, we heard you say great enthusiasm, great efforts. You're pretty happy with today?
Yeah, we talked about having a clean scrimmage. Which we had a few penalties, but not a ton, and not turning the ball over. And they did that. I thought defensively, lots of enthusiasm. They executed well. And so I was pleased overall.
What'd you see out of Pat? He still shows that ability to extend the play and make some things happen, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does. He made some big-time plays moving around, keeping things alive, and had some throws he'd like to have back, but he's been bouncing back and forth from baseball to football, so been very impressed with how he's handled that.
Cliff, one of the things we talked about, it's impressive to watch. You've got Stockton, you've got Washington, now you've got Felton, so you get a lot of options back there in the backfield.
Yeah, it's been fun. Coach Jinks has done a tremendous job really bringing that room together. They all cheer for each other. They all really like each other, and they all can bring something different when they're in there. You know, Justin had some big runs. Dre does his thing. Q has, we've asked him to block a little bit more.
Yeah, I didn't mention Q, but he had a big play
he's
also.
He's embraced that, and so it's fun to watch that room work together.
Coach, you just heard DeAndre a second ago talking about being one of those senior leaders. You got a lot of important seniors on this team. Have you had to say a lot to those guys this spring about how important this offseason is going into next year?
Not much. You know, the way last year ended, they came back hungry, and you're right. There's some very important players that have played a lot of football here at Texas Tech, and they want to go out the right way, and we want to do that for them. So you look at that senior group, and it's a bunch of really good players, and they've done a great job of leading.
Cliff, it's hard to tell in a situation like this, but we really liked what we saw out of that defense. As far as just swarming, going after a very, great pursuit would look like.
Yeah, Coach Gibbs really is, he's a breath of fresh air. With his approach, his rapport with the players, the way he handles things, and those guys are playing hard for him. That defensive staff, Coach Spavital, Coach Haverty, Coach Curtis, Coach Smith with the D-line, have embraced him, and it's been fun to watch them grow as a unit.
And he has said, I think our secondary will be in a better position to maybe make plays on the ball than they have in the past, but speak to what you see as an offensive coach and what he's trying to do to you guys.
Yeah, it's a lot more of a reading your quarterback, seeing the eyes, and he does a great job of mixing it up, staying multiple, and the main thing is they know where they're going, they're being disciplined, and they're playing hard, and that's all you can ask as a defensive coach.
Hey, the people of Midland really stepped up. It was a great atmosphere today.
Unbelievable. These 3 years have been incredible. Our players love coming out here. There's 10,000 fans. There's tailgating, so I just want to thank the community of Midland, and we'll be back again next year.
And as a player, it breaks up the monotony of going through the same thing, the same routine, and the same venue back in Lubbock.
No question. And it allows us as a program to practice going on the road, operations, how we want to handle it, and getting out there warming up and being in a different environment and going to work.
Real quick, don't want to end on a sour note, but do anything on the injury situation with Jalen?
Yeah, I don't think it's as bad as it initially looked, but we'll see. I think it scared him more than anything, and so hopefully that's the case.
Yeah, we didn't like seeing you out there, because when you're out there checking on him, usually that may not be a good thing.
He was in a lot of pain. He's a kid who's rehabbed a bunch, and I have a special place in my heart for him, because he's worked hard to get back, so I'm hoping that's not too bad.
Well, Coach Kingsbury, thank you for joining us.
Appreciate it.
Thanks for having us down here.
Thank you, Coach.
Again, we look ahead to the 2015 schedule. We talked a lot about that as we take a look here at the upcoming schedule and level. As you look at this, obviously the Big 12 is always going to provide lots of challenges.
Yeah, it is, and I think that you have a situation where you have a very, very difficult non-conference game there on September 19th in Fayetteville, Arkansas, as they will likely be a top 25 team and heading into the season, and stopping the run will be obviously the deal there. But then you've got TCU and Baylor right after that. I'm the two likely top five, top seven teams, and so yeah, that three-game stretch will be crucial right there as a schedule somewhat backloaded there. Is it playing at Texas on Thanksgiving again? But it should be, a fun schedule. And, I know that they're chomping at the bit to get back out there and prove themselves after the way last year ended.
And, of course, we're going to have a renovated Jones AT&T Stadium. One of the reasons why we're here this afternoon, because of the construction and the remodeling being done at Jones AT&T Stadium, new seats being put in, and lots of other a lot of infrastructure type work also being put into the stadium. As you take a look there, and again, nowhere to sit if you'd been there today.
Yeah, and I think what people don't realize is that, the way it looks right there, it's about to look completely different in a couple of weeks as they really start tearing it up and putting the new seats and all that stuff in. But it's really going to, I think Kirby Hocutt said it best, it's really going to pop, and the fans will really, brand new red seats, as there's been some different shades of red in the interior of that stadium, and the stadium's been there a while, but they continue to, it seems like always something being done to Jones AT&T, and trying to up update it, renovate it, and all that stuff, and that that's what's going on right now.
It's a busy weekend.
Let's call it that, right?
Yeah, that's right.
you know, we'll have a situation back there in Lubbock next year and all that, but can't wait for the season to get here, and ought to be fun.
Yeah, and today, again, was a different kind of situation because you didn't have you had kind of a funky situation at quarterback you've had all spring, and so I think they may do with what they could do in a different locale. And again, I think we got to see a lot of guys flash maybe some talent, and I think you can look ahead that certainly 4-8 has been something that's been on everyone's mind this right. spring to wipe that out of their mouth and move forward.
Yeah, and I think from the head coach on down, and you know, Cliff admitted the other day we've been laying a little low. I mean, we're not real proud. Don't want to. You know, we haven't really accomplished anything, and so we're trying to take care of business and stay quiet and work hard and roll our sleeves up and do all those things. You hear DeAndre Washington, one of the senior spokespeople on this team right there, really kind of echo that sentiment in the locker room. And I think, you know, Pete Robertson and Brandon Jackson and Raven Clark, and there's so many, Jakeem Grant, and a lot of seniors that this is it for them. And so, you know, and you heard Kirby Hokut say it earlier, too. This summer, after these last five or six practices happen, you know, I think that this summer will be really when, you know, you decide what kind of year it's going to be and those off-season workouts and all that stuff.
All right. Thank you to the folks of Midland for hosting us down here at Grande Communication Stadium. Thank you to everyone here on the Texas Tech TV on Fox crew. Great job from everyone here. I mean, this was a big production to move it all down here to Midland to make sure that the railroad ran and ran on time and ran efficiently. We appreciate all those guys for their hard work and effort. Thank you to Courtney Davis, who's down there on the field right now as she listens to Cliff Kingsbury with his post-game press conference. And thanks from us, Chris Level, Robert Chivinet. Thanks for joining us here at Texas Tech TV on Fox.